sit. We open our ears and our hearts now and know that we are in for a wonderful message. So it's my privilege to turn over the podium to Reverend John Scott, our pastor.
Thank you. Morning, family. A special welcome to all of you, to my heart and to the heart of this beautiful sanctuary this morning, and welcome to those who join us in consciousness by watching us on the World Wide Web. One of the interesting things about being a minister, you know, or a practitioner or a truth student of any sort, is that every time you prepare a message or a lesson or want to share something of truth with someone, you can be sure that it is as much for you as it is for your audience or your listener. So I decided that my encouragement, which most of you know is what I call my Sunday messages, rather than a sermon, it's an encouragement to encourage us to reach for our highest and our best. I decided that my encouragement this morning would be based on Jesus' advice to us not to be anxious. So just because we had started a new year, you know, and many of us are anxious about what lies ahead. But little did I know that, you know, as people were wondering about what ifs and how am I going to make it and am I on the right track, that I would also have to be practicing what I preach. During the brief illness of my dear friend and during his transition, my dear friend Andrew Foster. And you know, as I stood holding the hand of my friend, the words of the master teacher taken from his Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 6, 25 to 30, took on new meaning for me. So I want to read the passage for you. Therefore I say unto you, be not anxious for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than food and the body than raiment? Behold the birds of the heaven that they sow not, neither do they reap nor gather into barns, and your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are not ye of much more value than they? And which of you, by being anxious, can add one cubit unto the stature of his life? And why are ye anxious concerning raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. Yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God doth so clothe the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe ye, O ye of little faith? So you have to see a minister standing beside the bed of his friend, holding his hand, and he has on one of those gowns that hospitals give you that are designed to demoralize you. It not have no back. It have two little tied at tie, so you're behind her, so it's exposed. And it took me back to a time when I was going into Natal Hospital to have a minor operation, and I carefully made certain every T-shirt matched every shorts, pajamas matched the dressing gown. And you see, when you catch a hospital, none of that worked because you can't pull it over your head with all the tubes and, you know, IVs and what have you. And I thought to myself, really, you know, Jesus knew what he was talking about. Consider the lilies, you know. And I thought, well, I look pretty good in a gown myself, not Solomon in all his glory. But the beautiful Jesus is really advising us not to be anxious. It really makes me blush to think how sometimes we make such a big deal over what we want to wear, what we don't have to wear, what we shall eat, what we shall drink. And, you know, when you boil it down, it doesn't really matter. Because what life is looking at and what God is looking at is what you have in here. And it's not made by Prada or Gucci or Coach or Yves Saint Laurent. You know, it's made by something much greater, much more beautiful, much more awesome. And so I went home from visiting with Andrew one evening and I just said, yes, let me put down the anxiety and concentrate on how I can be the very best friend I know. Because that's what really matters when the chips are down or when you know, the time has come to look at our lives and to evaluate who we are and what we are and where we're going. And so when Jesus says, do not be anxious, what he's saying is that you can't change your circumstances by worrying about yourself. Your anxious thoughts will not pay the bills, will not reap the harvest or fill the barn. And in fact, worrying about what you don't want ensures that you'll get more of it. Because as we know, the law of attraction magnetizes to us whatever we dwell upon. So the more you think about what you don't want, the more you're attracting it to you. When you let go and relax and trust God, life fulfills itself in you and as you. For the truth is, my friends, we are spiritual beings and our lives are lived from inside out. Just after Jesus advises us not to be anxious, he advises us in Matthew 6, verse 33, seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Here again, he's advising us to seek first to be, and then we will have. So it's being first, being in the consciousness, before we can have what it is we want to have. It is a law of life that to have more, you have to be more. Success cannot be measured by the material goods you have accumulated, and success can only be known by the level of consciousness which you have achieved. So instead of being anxious, become still and enter the kingdom by acknowledging your spiritual unity with infinite mind and rest quietly in the truth of the divinity that you truly are. Remind yourself that you have a changeless relationship with the principle of life which knows no obstacles. Isaiah 65 verse 24 assures us, and I quote, before they call, I will answer, unquote. The I here is the presence and power in you that is always working for your highest good. If you have a decision to make today, know that there is a right choice even before you begin to weigh the pros and cons. Friends, the Father knows, the God self of you knows what is correct and what is the right move to make. And if you are desirous of a new job or a new relationship or whatever it is you have set your heart upon, right now know that there is a right and perfect outcome in the mind of God for you. And therefore you need not be anxious. Jesus is saying that when you have a problem, no matter what it may be or how serious it may appear, don't worry about it. Don't take the problem inside and ponder it, because that just brings more of the same. Instead, become still and acknowledge the guiding principle and the all-sufficient substance of the universe within you. Have faith in God and have faith in yourself and in your innate divinity. Be not therefore anxious for the morrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Simply put, don't worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow can take care of its own business. Indeed, every day has its own challenges. The word evil here simply means the unrevealed potential for good. Every day contains the potentialities for great things, even those potentialities may be hidden from your immediate understanding. Ours is then the joyous task of uncovering the good and discovering the hidden blessings that await each and every one of us. But we can only do this one day, and I dare say one moment at a time. So instead of worrying about tomorrow, concentrate on unwrapping the gift of today. That's why we call it the present. If you really think about it, most of our thoughts, you know, are about what we shall eat and drink and wear tomorrow. It's all related to the future, isn't it? Many people scrimp and save to provide for the rainy day, while depriving themselves of today. It leads to a sort of neurosis filled with subtle fears about the future, and we get tied to our fears with the result that we save our best linen and our best crockery and our best silver and whatever it is we have at home for what we call special occasions. Certain clothes, too, are regarded as too good to wear every day, and so we deny ourselves the pleasures of life now because they would cost too much and we have to put down that money in case we need it for our old age. The Indian Jesuit priest and modern-day mystic Anthony de Mello, known for his parables and storytelling, in a book titled Rediscovering Life, tells this story to illustrate how we get tied to our baseless illusions and fears. It's a story about a camel trader who is journeying across the Sahara Desert. The party pitches a tent for the night, and the servants drive pegs into the ground and tie the camels to the pegs. Then they come in to say to the master, sir, there are only 19 pegs and we have got 20 camels. How do we tie the 20th camel? And the master said, look here, these camels are stupid animals. Just go through the motions of tying up the camel and he'll stay put for the night. Which is what they did. And which is what the camel did. He stayed put, just as the master had predicted. The next morning, they were pulling up the tent to continue on their journey, but the servants came to complain that all the camels were following except this one. That one refused to budge. Him now go nowhere. And the master said, you forgot to untie him. They said, oh yes, so they went through the motions of untying him. De Mello makes the point that this is an image of our human condition. We're scared about things that are not. We're tied to things that don't really exist. They're illusions, they're falsehoods, they're beliefs, they're not realities, but they keep us rooted to this spot, unable to move forward. It's like the Zen master who was exceedingly gracious to a group of visiting university dons. You know, he received them in his quarters, but he declined to answer their questions or to be drawn into their deep theological speculations about life. To his disciples, who marveled at this, he said, can one talk about the ocean to a frog in a well, or about the divine to people who are restricted by their concepts? Unquote. So my friends, if you are tied to an old fear, a fear of failure perhaps, which is preventing you from initiating the new venture that you have been contemplating, or if perhaps you are trapped in the well of your old prejudices about people who may be different from you or hold different ideas about life from you, or if you are tethered firmly, my friends, to the hurts of yesteryear and what people did you or did not do, today is the day to let go, to untie the camel and move with confidence towards your goals for 2016. Do not be anxious. Anxiety will paralyze you. And this brings me to part one of your assignment for this week. You thought you were going to get away, but regulars at the Temple of Light, Center for Spiritual Living in beautiful Jamaica, know that whenever I speak, I always give an assignment. Your mission, should you decide to undertake it, is to read Matthew 6, verses 25 to 30. Write it down. Matthew 6, verses 25 to 30, every morning before leaving home. You may even want to write it out in your journal and put a sticky note on your desk or on the fridge which just says Matthew 6, 25 to 30, to remind you to let go of your anxieties and to let God have control of your life. Matthew 6, verses 25 to 30, read it every morning as a spiritual discipline. Let me see a show of hands of those who are willing to take on the challenge. Oh, very good. Let me sparkle you. In 2 Kings chapter 4, verses 1 to 8, there's a story that could quite easily be the story of many people within the sound of my voice this morning. In fact, you know, all Bible stories can be read in the light of our own experience, for in a very real sense, the stories in the Bible are stories about our own relationship with the God of our understanding. So if you begin to read the Bible in the knowledge that this is your story you're reading, the names may be different and the places, but it's really about you, you begin to have a new understanding of the power of the message that is being conveyed. So in 2 Kings, in this story, a woman's husband dies, leaving her in debt. In those days, the penalty was that the sons would have to be sold into slavery in order to pay the debt. You're all familiar with that story. The woman goes to Elisha in distress, and Elisha asks her the $24 million question. What do you have in the house? What do you have in the house? And the woman says, nothing. I don't have anything. You don't understand, I don't have anything. I'm bereft. I have nothing. All I have is one small jar of oil. Elisha instructs her to borrow as many containers as she can and then shut the door and begin pouring the oil into the containers. She does as she's instructed, and of course, as you know, as many containers as she had, they were filled. This is a wonderful story. The oil only stopped when there were no more containers to be filled. The oil, my friends, represents your flow of good. And in the Bible, when you read about a house, it means the house of your consciousness. So Elisha was asking, what do you have in your consciousness? Got it? For the flow of good to fill. So all you need to start the good flowing copiously in your life is to turn from the idea of one dege-dege container, as we say in Jamaica, to the abundance of containers. Metaphysically, this means that you can prosper to the extent your consciousness expands to receive that prosperity. But you know, so many of us, when we are anxious like the widow, focus on what we don't have. Notice she told Elisha she had only one jar of oil. How often do you say, I have only so much money? Never belittle the money you have in hand, my friends. In fact, whenever you handle money, bless it. No matter how small it may appear to you, the universe does not know anything about big or little. It regards $100 million quadrillion the same as it does a penny and a red cent. So don't belittle money. Don't speak of it in disparaging terms. In Jamaica, instead of saying only, we usually say uncle. My uncle have $1,000 left. Well, bless it and watch it increase and multiply. So the second part of your assignment is to affirm this every morning on awakening. As your eyes flutter open, say, God is my instant, constant, and abundant supply. Can we say that? God is my instant, constant, and abundant supply. I always have what I require to live the life more abundant. I always have what I require to live the life more abundant. And then add the gratitude. Thank you, God. So here is the affirmation. God is my instant, constant, and abundant supply. I always have what I require to live the life more abundant. Thank you, God. Can we do it together? God is my instant, constant, and abundant supply. I always have what I require to live the life more abundant. I'm not convinced. Let's try it again with conviction. God is my instant, constant, and abundant supply. I always have what I require to live the life more abundant. Thank you, God. Then to your neighbor say, God is your instant, constant, and abundant supply. You always have what you require to live the life more abundant. Namaste. Come on, if you can remember. God is your instant, constant, and abundant supply. You always have what you require to live a life more abundant. Namaste. God is your instant, constant, and abundant supply. You always have what you require to live a life more abundant. Namaste. Miss said your neighbor, not the whole church. Friends, as a beloved child of God, you are richly endowed with an all-sufficiency in all things. There really is no need to be anxious. Untie the camel. untether yourself from all those old ideas and beliefs, the what ifs and the I shoulda and I coulda and I woulda, and focus your attention on the instant, constant, and abundant supply of your ever-loving, ever-giving, infinitely wealthy Father, Mother, God within you. In the story in 2 Kings, Elisha represents the power of God. The widow turned to this power and was blessed. And we too can turn to that Christ presence within us and live as consciously aware of our sonship and daughtership as we can every waking moment. Read the story of Do Not Be Anxious every morning this week and affirm as you open your eyes, God is my instant, let me hear it, constant and abundant supply. I always have what I require to live the life more abundant. And I didn't say what I need, for we don't pray from our consciousness of needing anything. We can't need what is already provided. I don't have to say I need sardines. My cupboard has 3 tins at all times. So I know it's there. And if I feel for sardines, I say, there are sardines in my pantry. So know that whatever it is that you require is already firmly there for you. The gift has already been given. Instead of worrying about tomorrow, open the gift of God's present and live in it radiantly, abundantly, and to the honor and glory of your Heavenly Father. God loves you, and so do I. Namaste.